Good morning and welcome to worship on this beautiful Sunday morning. They say April showers bring May flowers, right? So I had a little shower overnight, so we'll have lots of beautiful flowers in May, and there's many beautiful flowers already out to enjoy in this spring season. It's the season of spring, but it's also the season of Easter. Today's the fifth Sunday in the season of Easter. Two more Sundays, sixth and seventh, and then it's Pentecost in just a few weeks. As we gather for worship, I encourage you to take that friendship pad and register your attendance with us, especially visitors. Share with us some information. We can tell you more about our church, and let's all try and remember to wear our name tags, including me, and I forgot mine with this outfit today. And we're going to work on temporary name tags for visitors, because we realize visitors are missing out on name tags. You see someone you know, say hello to them. In fact, we do have some visitors with us today from Germany. Welcome, and Eric, you'll have to speak to these folks at the coffee, our friends or relatives of Row Gift. Welcome to our church today. Our opening hymn is on an insert rather than in your hymn book. So in a few moments, the melody will be familiar, but some beautiful Easter lyrics to share together. So as we listen to those bells, let us stand and be prepared to share in our call to worship. Into this world we are born. Into this day we awake. Into this church we are welcomed. So let us worship our God this day. The Lord's Prayer. Gracious God, we come to you this day in worship and praise for all your goodness, all your grace, and all your mercy. At this time of year, we see the beauty of your creation in the flowers and the blossoms and the promise of new life that Easter brings to mind. We see all around us, and we give you thanks for that. But we see around our nation and around our world many places where there is violence and trouble. We pray for our college campuses. We pray that there would be peaceful demonstrations and the right to protest and free speech would be honored, but also there would be respect for one another and there would be no violence. We pray for peace. We pray for peace in Gaza. We pray for a return of hostages. We pray for a path to a lasting peace for all in that troubled land that we call holy. We pray for peace in Ukraine and other places around the world, knowing that we need your vision for what our world could be. We pray for those in our church family and in our lives who are going through a difficult time. We pray for the Dale family with these medical crises that they are dealing with. We pray for all those others that we name before you in our hearts, who may be going through a difficult time with their own health, the health of a loved one, grieving the loss of a loved one, maybe other crises in life, financial struggles, emotional struggles, whatever it may be. May they know that they are not alone, that they can take the hand of those around them, their church family, and most of all, you. You will be with them in their time of need. We pray all these things in the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning. The first reading is Psalm 16, 5 through 11. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my law. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me. I keep the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be moved. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my soul rejoices. My body also rests secure. For you do not give me up to Sheol, or let your faithful one see the pit. You show me that the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore. The word of the Lord.
He just remembered. The Apostle Paul, of course, is the most prolific writer of the New Testament letters. And the letter to the Corinthians, the first letter, chapter 15, is a very important chapter. And I'd encourage you to take out your pew Bible in front of you. And it doesn't say the page number there in front of you. Does someone want to open that up and give the page number? The Bible I have here in front of me is not the same version. What is that page number? Somebody look up 1 Corinthians 15. 935? Page 935. Because we'll be referring back to it. I'll put on my professor's hat today. It'll be a little more like a class of going through the text together. It's just such an important chapter. I'm going to read for you the first eight verses, and then we'll read several more throughout the message today. But before we begin, notice the title. I think you'll see where we're headed with this. Beg your pardon? I'm sorry, Wayne? Oh, I'm saying notice the title of my message.
Notice the title.
Yes, sorry. Okay. Listen now as I read the first eight verses of Paul's letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts together be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us. Above us, only sky. Imagine all the people living for today. Well, if you're old enough, that song is part of the soundtrack of your life. John Lennon captured the right sentiment at the right time, didn't he? It was 1971. And the Vietnam War was raging, and the memory of the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King and Robert Kennedy and race riots in the streets of our cities was still very fresh. It's a beautiful song, and Eric played those opening chords perfectly. All I had to do was tell him, and he knew it. No, not a piece of music in front of him. It's a song that is genius in its simplicity and poetic in its imagery. Imagine. Just the word imagine takes you to a different place. Imagine a different world, a world without all the problems that we have now. I don't know about you, but I imagine that world all the time. The song is absolutely iconic. It was named one of the top 100 songs of the 20th century. Rolling Stone magazine put it at number 3 of that list. It was the theme song at the 2022 Winter Olympics, which put it back on the top 40 charts 50 years after it had been released. Some people took offense to the song, especially the line, "Imagine no religion too." Nothing to kill for or die for, and no religion too. We have to admit, though, religion has been the source of too much violence. It's a popular song that makes you dream of better ways to live, but the Apostle Paul would take issue with the message of the song. John Lennon says, "Imagine there is no heaven," and then suggests that that would make the world a better place. And Paul says, "Well, imagine there's no Easter, no resurrection of the dead, and that is not a better world. That's a disaster. That's a nightmare. Rather than make life more worthwhile, that would make life pointless." Paul says, "If all we are doing is living for today, we are of all people most miserable." Well, today is the 5th Sunday in the season of Easter. 5 weeks ago, we decorated the sanctuary with flowers, put on our best clothes, maybe even an Easter hat, gave the children Easter eggs and chocolate, and sang our alleluias. We shouted, Christ is risen indeed. We celebrated the empty tomb and for a moment stopped to believe in the resurrection of the dead. But then we go back to our daily lives, and if we stopped to think about it, we wouldn't know what to make of Easter. Did the resurrection really happen? If so, what happened? And what difference does it make? Is it just a metaphor? Or is there something about the resurrection that is central to our faith? Is there something about Easter that really does make life worthwhile? The Apostle Paul heard that people were casting doubt on the resurrection, and Paul found that totally unacceptable. He wanted to nip that in the bud. He sat down with his pen and wrote the most vigorous defense of the resurrection in all of Scripture. His original audience was the church in Corinth. These were educated, well-off people who had a pretty good life, and they wanted to enjoy life here and now. They were steeped in Greek philosophy and found this whole idea of resurrection a little hard to swallow. It turns out we are a lot like the people in Corinth. We have busy, interesting lives. We understand science and philosophy, and we don't want our religion to be based on any magical thinking. We want religion to be about the here and now, not the by and by. But as we take a brief look at what Paul has to say, I think you will see that he imagines Easter as doing both, providing hope for this life as well as the life to come. It's a long chapter, and there are many twists and turns in Paul's argument, so I'm going to lift out a few verses and summarize their meaning. And by the end, I think we will see that Easter is the inspiration that we all need right now. Easter brings into being the reality that we can only imagine. I began this message with the reading of verses 1 through 8 of chapter 15, and here Paul describes what is the gospel in a nutshell. The good news that he has given his life to sharing with others, and he expresses shock that some might be missing the point. He says the whole point of the good news is that Jesus died for our sins, was buried, and was raised again on the third day according to the Scriptures. Kind of sounds like the Apostles' Creed, doesn't it? The most basic creedal affirmation of the Christian faith. He then offers proof of the resurrection, as if he were in a court of law. He describes the witnesses. The risen Christ appeared to Peter, or Cephas, then the disciples, then more than 500 people, many of whom are still alive, he said. Well, by the way, Paul seemed to gloss over that it was the women who were the first to encounter the risen Christ, but he did go on to say something that was very interesting. He said, "And then he appeared also to me. I have seen the risen Christ. I know he is alive," Paul says. But guess what? Paul was not with the women or with the 12. He was not with Thomas when he touched his hands and feet. He was not even on the road to Emmaus. His encounter with Christ was long after the resurrection and even the ascension. Christ appeared to him in a very real way, but in a spiritual way. It was not too different from the way that you and I can encounter the risen Christ. It was on the road to Damascus, where he was knocked off, or we think of him on some horse or a mule perhaps, but he was knocked to the ground and he saw a bright light and heard a voice say, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" The people with him heard something but didn't see anything, so it was a very private spiritual encounter with Christ. It was the risen Christ, but it was not a physical encounter. So for Paul, the resurrection is more like, is much more than seeing a man who was dead get up and walk again. It was to experience the power and presence of Christ coming to him from beyond the physical realm. And so remember that as we continue with his argument. In verses 12 through 19, Paul goes directly to the issue at hand. He makes the connection between the resurrection of Christ and the resurrection of the dead. In other words, if you believe in the resurrection of Christ, you need to believe in your own resurrection. Easter is for you too. He writes in verse 12, "Now if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our proclamation is in vain, and your faith is in vain." For Paul, there is no point to our faith if it does not begin and end with the resurrection. In verses 30 to 32, he even goes so far as to say, "Why would I risk my life for a faith that is empty and void? What would be the point?" You know, he had faced persecution and he would ultimately die in a Roman prison. So without the resurrection, he says, he should have forgotten all that and lived with the philosophy of hedonism. He quotes scripture, "If the dead are not raised, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die." What's the point of that? Paul asks. So once he has their attention, and hopefully ours, he explains what the resurrection looks like. He makes a clear distinction between the physical and the spiritual. Verse 42, he says, "So it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown perishable is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a physical body, it is raised a spiritual body. If there is a physical body, there is also a spiritual body." And from there he reaches his crescendo of what all this means, and it is the most blessed hope imaginable. He goes on in verse 50, "What I am saying, brothers and sisters, is this: flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Look, I will tell you a mystery. We will not all die, but we will all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable body must put on imperishability, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When this perishable body puts on imperishability and this mortal body puts on immortality, then the saying that is written will be fulfilled: death has been swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O grave, where is your sting?" So now do you see? Easter changes everything. Because of Easter, Jesus is alive. Because of Easter, you and I will be raised to new life when this life is over. As Paul wrote in his second letter to the Corinthians, "For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens." I've shared those words hundreds of times at a funeral or at a graveside, and they give real comfort and hope. But you may be thinking, if religion and our faith is only about getting into heaven when we die, then I don't want anything to do with that kind of religion. I want religion that makes a difference here and now. And it does. Because we can face death without fear, we can face the challenges of today. We can face life. We can seek to relieve the suffering of others here and now, just as Jesus did when he walked this earth. But don't take my word for it. Paul ends this eloquent argument with a charge to do good works and make a difference in the world. Last verse of the chapter, verse 58, he says, "Therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, be steadfast, immovable, always excelling in the work of the Lord, because you know that in the Lord your labor is not in vain." Imagine that world. Imagine there's an Easter. It's easy if you try. Perhaps the best evidence we have of the power of Easter are the survivors of near-death experiences, but perhaps not for the reason you think. NDEs have become fairly common, partially because of modern medicine that can revive people who have technically died. Their heart is stopped, and before they are revived, they may have an experience of light and warmth and acceptance, and may even see loved ones who have died. But it's not that experience itself that proves the power of Easter. It's how they feel when they are brought back to life. They have a whole new attitude to life. They embrace each day as a gift. Rather than want to die to get back to heaven, they want to make the most of each day. Heaven can wait. It'll be nice when it comes, but it can wait. They want to tell people close to them how much they love them. They want to make a difference, to spread the good news that death is nothing to fear. It will be okay. When the time comes, it will be okay. All will be well. So imagine there is an Easter. It isn't hard to do. Jesus died and rose again for me and for you. Imagine all the people living beyond fear. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. Hope someday you'll join us, and the world will live as one. Amen. Talent given to God's glory. Well, that tune is going to be in your head all day, isn't it? Imagine. It kind of gets its way in there. But that's okay. Let it take you to some place where you can imagine Easter and the power it has in your life, the risen Christ and the gift that he is to you, and not only in this life, but in the life to come. Reflect on that chapter, that powerful chapter of 1 Corinthians 15, in Paul's defense of the resurrection, that if it is not true, we are of all people most miserable, he says. But it is true. Christ is alive. Come and have some coffee and fellowship and refreshment. Our youth group and Elizabeth put that together for us, so thank you to them. And now receive this benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each one of you. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.